Thank you, Peter, so much for coming and talking to us today. So in the run-up to the Kathleen Stock event at the Oxford Union, there were petitions and counter-petitions. There were people who said the event shouldn't go ahead at all because it just allowing her to speak was transphobic. And you yourself resigned from a position at a university, as Kathleen did, because your situation became untenable. So how did you feel looking at these scenes unfolding? Did you feel that your situations compared in a way?
My first thought when I saw that is there are no guns here in this country, largely. So my first thought was, oddly, as an American perspective, somewhat relieved that I knew that she was not going to get shot, because I always think about that when I do events in the United States. My second perspective was, what a stain on the institution. What a stain that the Oxford Union, whose entire purpose is to have debates, would have to deal with a very small group of megalomaniacs who want to limit the speech of others. Now, if they don't want to go, that's fine. Nobody, there should be no compulsion. Nobody should force them to go. The problem is that they want to force other people not to go. They want to shut down. It's a new type of totalitarianism, and it's a new type of authoritarianism.
So more than 40 academics signed a petition in favor of Kathleen being allowed to speak. And in that petition, they said that they believe that the university exists to promote the disinterested pursuit of truth via reasoned argument. But that seems to be, you know, what is really being disputed here. There are some people who believe that the university is for the disinterested pursuit of truth, and there are other people who take this sort of safetyist perspective. But it's more than just safetyism, isn't it?
I think it's their moral mind overriding their rational mind. I think they have a kind of hyper-moralism, and that shuts off or completely seals or closes any hope that they can evaluate reasoned evidence or argument, because they hold those positions for moral reasons. Now, when you said there are 40 people, I'd like to know how many people in total were on the faculty and 40 signed. In my experience, of course, this was when gender ideology was not in its infancy, but it hadn't matured to the level of derangement that it has now. There wouldn't be a single person who would have signed that. So you can tell that the tide is turning, and it's not just a across the pond thing. The tide is turning on the ideology. So the fact that 40 people signed it all is interesting.
So you were also involved in what came to be known as the gender studies hoax, where you and some of your colleagues submitted essentially fake journal articles that were accepted by peer-reviewed journals. And it showed up the academic industry really to be completely bankrupt. And yet nothing seems to have happened. There haven't been any consequences as a result of that, except for the people who were involved in submitting those journal articles in the first place. Can you tell us a bit more about that?
Yeah, I think we won the battle but lost the war. I think the ideologues who are pushing out propaganda, there's no politic way to say it. These are moral impulses by ideologues. And the people who have push this out and are driving this in peer-reviewed journals, they're not doing that because they have good evidence for what they believe. They're doing it because they want to forward moral ideas. That's the key to this whole thing. And when you understand that the movement, wokeism, critical social justice, whatever you want to call it, this is fundamentally a moral movement. It's not based upon evidence. So, for example, from what we talked about before, trans women and women's sports, there are no gotchas. So it's not as if you can give physical characteristics of the average male, physical characteristics of the average female and say, aha, see, gotcha. You know, biological men should not compete in women's sports. No, because for the people who are in the orbit of the ideology, trans women are women. They're just women, period. And it doesn't matter what the evidence is. The belief is a moral belief, and that if you do not understand that, you simply cannot understand gender ideology. Mm-hmm. The propositions of gender ideology are forwarded for moral reasons. They are not based in evidence. And not only are they not based in evidence, evidence is completely irrelevant to making one change one's minds about the moral belief.
We saw with what happened at Oxford that it wasn't all bad news. The Oxford Union actually held its ground. There were people who spoke out in favour of free speech and in favour of Kathleen Stock being allowed to air her views and talk at the union. So how optimistic are you that the situation is, you know, potentially getting better? Or do you think that, you know, the worst is yet to come?
The tide is turning, but the institutions are also captured. So in the academy, for example, you have people with jobs for life. It's called tenure. You cannot get them out once they're in. There's no question that the tide is turning. There's also no question about what damage it will do to our institutions before we finally extirpate the last vestiges of madness. The thing that's really important to understand is that this ideology is simply too idiotic to sustain. It's just simply too stupid. Everybody knows what a woman is. I'm looking at you, you're a woman. You know what a man is. You know that men have no place in women's spaces. You know that if a man goes into your bathroom, that individual is not there for, nothing positive is coming out of that. So the ideology itself is just, it's just too idiotic to sustain itself. And all it takes is a small group of people and then hopefully followed by a critical mass of people who stand up and saying that we're not going to take this anymore. This is too deranged.